the Gen YZ trendsetters, pushing new ideas, redefining the present, architecting the future. They are radical, innovative, unconventional, disruptive, yet focused. They cut across gender, creed or cradle, and are found in every sphere of life, every field of human endeavor. They share certain values, paramount among which is a desire to shake off orthodoxy and to impact positively on the society. Failure is alien to their imagination, I can imagine. Success is the key substance of their DNA. The big question is, how big is the success? How profound is the impact? Avant-garde, a true vision, will explore the world of these era-defining trendsetters and situate them within the broader dynamics of an ever-changing world. Welcome to what promises to be an exciting excursion into what can be considered as the mind of the future.
Of all the qualities that drive enterprise and progress, not many can have as profound an impact as the passion for any human activity. With the advancement in the field of artificial intelligence, emphasis is shifting radically from physical to mental capacities as key drivers of human enterprise. And with this advancement, a new generation of upwardly mobile personalities, the Gen YZ generation, are progressively re-engineering the enterprise space with unmatched zest and dignified accomplishment. For a long time, regular viewers of AIT's Signatures Early Morning Discussion program will not fail to notice the commanding presence of Dark Complexion, co-anchor of the program. Her voice often reverberated through the tool with emphatic predominance. Supported by a good academic background and solid professional mentoring and exposure to global best practices in broadcasting, this multi-talented, vivacious, and engaging lady has her hands in several pies, from broadcasting to philanthropy, media consulting, and politics. Her life so far is ample evidence that for anyone who is prepared to soar high, there's enough space in the sky to chart an enviable trajectory. I have the pleasure to introduce Miss Sydney Jack, our first guest on our program, Avant-Garde. Before you wonder who we are talking about, she is no other person than a familiar TV diva, Adora Onyechere, whose marriage to a heartthrob of 10 years, Asowari Sydney Jack, a broadcast engineer, was solemnized last Saturday. It was quite a dramatic event, and we were able to secure this interview with her only a few days after our wedding to a heartthrob. This is True Vision Television, TVTN, the online stablemate of True Vision newspaper, and my name is Gabriel Atumei. I am your host on today's program. Adora, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
For several years, your face has dominated the tool, from Britain to Nigeria, interviewing personalities and producing programs. But here you are today. This is not exactly like the case of the hunter being hunted, but I am delighted to have the pleasure of subjecting you to the same experience that your guests often face while on the hot seat. On a very light note, during your well-appointed wedding, your husband revealed that he had been planning for the event for 10 years. Did he mean that he could not take his eyes off you? So tell us about it.
Well, I think in the better words, I think that would be his narrative, because he's the one who waited and planned the planning. I just think that for me, you know, when we talked about it, and we'll talk about it, he said the first time he saw me, and he knew that this was the one. Okay. And, you know, he tried various ways to try and get in touch with me and all of that. But, you know, being some sort of celeb and a personality on TV, mm-hmm. you know, there were a lot of walls around me. Yeah. And I was often very, very careful about letting down my guard. So it was difficult, actually. So people would tell you that, I sit on a high horse, or I'm very standoffish, or I'm a snob, or, you know, I've heard comments like that. But then, you know, you have to watch those and filter those that you engage with. But I think along the line, We met in two occasions, but at that point, I suspect, you know, we were both at different points in our lives, maybe with different partners at then. Yeah. And, you know, I didn't think anything about it because it wasn't an interaction of extending friendship beyond the normal professional engagement. So for me, yes, when you say he's waited 9 to 10 years, I can imagine what he means by that. Yeah.
Thank you. Being a very busy media personality, how do you plan to achieve work-life balance?
That's an interesting question. And I've had this conversation with my father. And, you know, before I got married, before I took the step, he asked me this question. He said, I know how much you love your work. You're a journalist, you're a broadcaster, you are an advocate, you're a community journalist, you like to engage. So how are you going to balance this? You know, are you ready for committing yourself to taking some time off work? Are you ready to submit to your husband? Because, you know, my dad would tell you that I'm quite a very strong-willed person and, you know, quote-unquote stubborn, but I like to use the word strong-willed. And, you know, you said this time you're not going to be Madam Independent, you know. So are you ready? And I need you to think about this and come back to me before you even think about even introducing him to me. And I told my dad, I had quite studied the backgrounding and I have been friends with him for a while. And I understood one thing. He's a man who's set on doing, when he sets his mind on something, I mean, he goes for it. He's not a talker like my father, very calm. He's also a very extremely patient person, very firm in his decisions, highly cerebral. For me, that was the first thing that ticked my box because, you know, I'm a curious person and I always said that if I was going to marry somebody, the person has to be 150% more intelligent than I was. So, yes, I had that conversation and I think it was something I deliberately said to myself that, you know, being an on-air personality who wakes up by 4 a.m. every day, 5 days a week to get to work, anchor a show for 3 hours, 6 to 9, and then also have some office time. You know, we had that conversation as a couple. And, you know, he's very supportive. And, you know, there's this understanding that it's not about me now. It's about us. And so decisions should be made collectively. Ambitions should be drawn out collectively. And he's also my manager, you know, one way or the other. He manages, you know, my engagement in terms of if I want to have a meeting, I bounce it off him. If I want to have suggestions, I bounce it off him. And I've been often quite surprised that a lot of the advices he gives me, even though he's not in the media space, and he is very strategic. And, you know, my husband has a very political mind, having worked in that space. Yet he also has a very, very constructive, partisan way of thinking. So I first of all felt safe that one, he was not going to stop me from, you know, my job, and that my ambition, you know, to actually save the world, which is what my dad likes to say, will not suffer. But now, instead of saving the world, I'm saving species one space at a time, and that's why he comes in. Yeah,
thank you. I guess that at your wedding last Saturday, applauded when some dignitaries expressed a desire to return for another celebration. Any plans?
Oh, well, I mean, you know, children are in the hands of God. Yeah. We'll just do our parts as human beings and wait.
So you have had a blistering and very successful career as a journalist. Did you plan from the outset to be one?
That's a very interesting question. When I went to school in England, I started off reading law. And it was quite an interesting course. But then I felt that, you know, just every day I went to class, I was saying, you know, repeating and analyzing cases that happened 1970, 1902, when I wasn't born. I felt bored by it, you know. According to the case of Robinson and Rebecca in 1873. And I'm like, why do I have to keep doing this? You know, so I went to my tutor one day and I'm like, I don't think this is good out for me. And he already saw my zest in arts. You know, I was already the pan secretary, vice president for the Caribbean African Association in my school. I was also already on, you know, on the student radio, you know, on off days volunteering to, you know, sort of write scripts, not really get on radio. And, you know, I was a great writer and I still I am. And for me, I was in love with filmmaking. And I think that was where I focused on, you know, while I was still really in love. But then after that conversation, next semester, I just changed courses and then I moved from the school I was in to another school that gave me a more groundbreaking entry in the course that I wanted to, which was English, and then broadcasting minor. And from there, I was able to work, you know, have some work experiences with Ben TV, BBC, and Channel 4. And I started to, you know, write scripts and screenplays for several programs. And I think for me, also having a bit of speech problems growing up, you know, I stammered a lot and I had speech apraxia. I didn't think speaking on television or going on real-time TV was what I thought I would be doing. But, you know, I had already grown in the area of directing, you know, documentaries, films, and I had such fantastic passion for that, and that was what I was looking forward to. And you know, you need to see me in the field where I'm, you know, doing cutaways. That was where my energy came in. But I think one day, while working with one of my presenters doing her screenplay, and she said, I heard them say she wasn't going to come in for 3 days because she had the flu. And so because I was the one who was already doing the scripts and you know, ordering her on, I was asked to take her place, and I found it laughable. First of all, I'm like, I'm not like a screen queen. I don't think I have that feature. And then secondly, in terms of having to engage the camera, it just felt very strange for me because I was always behind the cameras. But I think from there, first, second time trial, and that was it. So I think the first thing I was told by the director and the cinematographer was, make love to the camera. And I will never forget that. Okay. Forget your script, forget just, you know what the title is. And I said, yes, it's a make love to the camera and tell the camera your truth. Speak from the heart. And that was it. And I think that has guided, you know, my love for the arts, especially being an on-air personality. When I am in front of the camera, I make sure that I see it as an opportunity to speak for the last time. And say the truth for the last time to those people who are watching me. I feel and I take the opportunity as if I would never see them again. And so this is the first and the best time. So for me, that's why, you know, a lot of people say, oh, you're hard, your questions when you get on TV shows, you're so. And I said no, because sometimes you are speaking to someone outside the television and you're trying to find truth for millions of other Nigerians and people in diaspora. And that's how I look at it. I am one citizen given the opportunity to speak for others. So I think for me, that's what, you know, that's what gives me the energy to want to say, you know what, I love my job and I do understand that, yes, this job is something I want to continue to do to serve humanity. However, now that there is a family, I have a partner in progress who understands my job. My husband is very professional. He's a sound and acoustic engineer. You know, when I'm on air, sometimes he's telling me, let them adjust your microphone. The audio is not really well put. He's been in the industry for decades. He's a great cinematographer. He's a great producer. He's a great editor. So it's like I have a one-stop shop manager, you know. So for me, I'm very privileged. And I think that's what guides me to say that it's going to be easier to balance work and life with someone like that.
Yeah, that's true. So what's the difference, coming from your background, what's the difference between journalism practice in Britain where you started and Nigeria? And do you consider the Nigerian media ecosystem suitable for the achievement of the constitutional role of the...
Well, I think you already know the answer, even asking me that, but I think the structures are different. First of all, there is a more enabling environment. The regard and respect for the profession is the momentum is higher outside Nigeria. Unions are privileged, and you know they're like the realm of guardian of free speech of human rights, of people interaction, you know, and it's often given that kind of respect. And you would not find, there is nothing like brown envelope, you know, there is nothing like chua chua, there's nothing like, you know, political engagement of the media. I mean, they can take sides with, you know, an opinion, but you will not, it's not on money basis. But the problem here is the fact that we haven't come to a place where we have revered and regarded, you know, journalists as the voice of the people and at the fourth rim, you know, fourth estate of the realm in Nigeria. I think that, you know, journalism and the media are the custodians of truth and history in our dynasty here as Nigerians. And I don't think we have seen that yet, even in the bills that we make in the at the legislative arms, and how, you know, journalists are gagged and often arrested, sometimes killed in the line of duty. The responsibility of organizations, private and state-owned, to journalists is very poor. And I think the poorest of them all is the welfare and the remuneration packages for, you know, people in the field. I mean, you have someone covering war, covering crisis, and then they lose their lives and their families are left to cater to themselves after 3 months of stipends being paid to them. So I think outside, you know, soldiers and the military, I think journalists are the next people to consider as doing a selfless service for the country. And sometimes I often say that they are the ones, you know, who already start serving the country even without having to do, you know, National Youth Service Corps. So I feel there must be a review of how journalists, broadcasters, whether in the print or the traditional media, and the ever-rising case of social media influencers and you know, online broadcasters, to review terms of engagement and to also review what I call, you know, the deliberate act of support, whether it be through remuneration, welfare, security, and social insurance. It's poor, I think that if that is done, we would have a better playing ground for journalists to achieve the rights and the voices of people and persons in Nigeria without having to leverage on political intrigues and negotiating their voices for a paltry sum of, you know, stipends. The brown envelope will go. The media will really be the custodian of truth. And then the issues of propaganda management will now no longer just be based on individual, but protecting the brand Nigeria. So there needs to be a lot to be done. And I think that there should be a review in terms of training and updating training for personalities, especially those in the core mandate of media engagement. So on-air personalities, editors, directors, cinematographers, and including, you know, floor managers. So I think they should all look at that, you know, as an essential kit to keep updating the kind of training in tangent with what is happening in the world. I mean, of course, you know, the adventure of Netflix has taken over, you know, the screen space. Nobody really watches news these days on TV. Nobody is reading newspaper. So what are you doing to upgrade? What are you doing to update? You cannot make those channels obsolete because of the evolving nature of what we have online. We have to find a way to update, to increase, and to create those spaces as you know, as areas of engagement for people to get employed, because that's what offers real-time employment.
Prior to assuming the office as SA to former governor of Imo State, Emeka Iyedioha, it was speculated that you were offered a job by a popular global network. What is your response to those who think you passed up a very good opportunity to shoot into global record?
Well, I went to run for state assembly to represent Okigwe constituency, and it was what I call the baptism of fire. However, I also think that I would not change that experience for anything, because for two reasons. It brought me closer to the people. I understood the dynamics of what, you know, the language of need for the communities as against the political engagement happening at the legislature. So what I did find out was that, you know, the communities may want something, and, you know, deals are being made without having to harmonize and prioritize first things first. So there was a huge gap, and there is still a huge gap between the leadership and the led, especially at the community level. And so that's what gave me insight. And it further buttressed my point to look deeply into community engagement and rural development, which was one of the heights of my profession before I left to run. I was deeply involved in community journalism, and that was what gave me an insight to say, you know what, I cannot just sit pretty behind the TV talking about change the world, and not want to do something about it. And of course, I didn't understand how Nigeria worked before, you know, becoming a heroine and flying into the political space. But I learned both the hard things, and I also got exposed to some of the very real things happening. And I also got to understand the politics of, you know, the non-servicing of issues within the space, because I often thought that people didn't know how to do it. But then I realized that some people just didn't want to serve, even though they had the opportunity. So for me, going into that space, had a lot of bashing from some of my, in fact, my parents were worried and didn't want me to get into the space because of the fear of, you know, how the politics of the East, especially in Imo State, was for a young girl. And I could understand their fear. But, you know, having done that, and I didn't get past it, I still say I won, because once you get to the ballot and you're voted or voted in or voted out, your name is in the ballot. Okay. So for me, that was the winning syndrome. So when I didn't, and I went to serve, before I went to serve and I had that opportunity, I did a lot of consultation. And I, you know, what came back to me was the fact that these people supported you, and they held a lot of sacrifices out to come out for you. And to just up and leave and go without considerations of their hearts and their belief in you would be saying that, you know, it was good you lost, because you probably wouldn't have even represented them well. So I decided to say, you know what, I have the capacity to fulfill this mandate and also show, you know, extra capacity in the responsibility that I was being charged. Because one thing I know about Right Honorable Emeka Ihedioha was his capacity to identify talent. And, you know, he's very honorable when he comes, you know, into the space of giving young people opportunity, regardless of political parties. I ran under AA, he's BDP, you know, and he also showed his sense of, you know, given to organize and to give a space to unity governments to be able to run the best state with the right mind. So I took the opportunity to give back to my people, and also to be able to showcase the fact that the belief in the strengths that I had for the role that I was chosen for was not in vain.
Thank you. You are obviously enamored by the life of giving. Tell us about your NGO and humanitarian activities.
Okay, so I started off with Yellow Jerrycan Save a Child Foundation. And that was because at the onset of displacement, we were quite worried about the number of women and girls that were displaced, and children, and some of the influx into, you know, the FCT at the mall at that time. And one of the things we did notice was the abuse and, of course, the malnourishment of children and the lack of, you know, welfare, you know, as far back as 2011, 2012. And we started, you know, ad hocly reaching out, taking visitations to homes, foster communities who were, you know, housing some of this displaced persons, before we now decided to officially launch YJS. And we started to communicate our partnerships to both the legislative arm of government and to several parts of, you know, the MDAs. And we were able to do a lot of training. And one of the projects which we did extensively was the Love, Reach Out and Touch project, which looked at, you know, one, the issue of Rice Is Not Enough, which was one of the projects we launched with the late barrister Esther Ozoma, who was also my mentor, and Asma Hujoda as well. And, you know, beyond that, after that, we saw that a lot had been done in terms of humanitarian intervention. The Northeast Development Commission was formed, and a lot of the engagement and advocacy continued. But I always realized that there was really a slim space for women's participation in governance and politics after I had run. And having run the elections and come out, I was really passionate and troubled on what we could do in terms of raising voices and creating enabling, you know, spaces for women, especially in governance, not just politics and policy making. And so Gender Strategy Advancement International was birthed after consultations with some of my mentors. And the idea behind GSI is to, one, be a building, you know, a bridge builder and an advocate to see how we can shrink the spaces and have more women in policy decision making and also in governance. And thereby, when that happens, what that happens is that women are more policy literate enough to run for politics, to run for elections. And I think one of the greatest things for us is to tell every woman to start from where you are, to give back. So you don't have to wait till when you go into a political office or maybe you're elected into an office. Start from where you are. And that means speaking out for where there are, you know, anti-women policies, non-activated policies, lack of implementation, like the recently revised national gender policy, you know, is a good document to run with. So we're asking, you know, what are the state governments doing? What are the MDAs doing? How do we activate all of those documents and policies at the state level? Currently, we're going into a 2023 election. Several states do not have women fielded in their candidates. So how do you begin to shape policies that help women in those states without having women in office? So these are some of the gray areas. And if we pride ourselves as a giant of Africa and we cannot make use deliberately of the bigger number or the higher currency of our population, which is women, you have over 49.5% of women voters, you know, now with the new registration. So it's a huge currency. So women are going to vote, yet there are not a lot of women to be voted for. So that's also an injustice. And that's one of the reasons why the area of my, you know, non-governmental organizations focuses on women and gender and also on children.
What was your upbringing like? The influence of your parents, siblings, and your environment? Because I know you have a pedigree to that extent. Your dad is well known, and I think your mom too is well known. So tell us about.
Well, I think everything that I am in terms of women's rights, advocating for inclusion, I took from my mother. My mom is such a champion for, you know, girl child, for the girl child education, having a voice. She's an astute speaker herself. Having also read English, she was also Commissioner for Women Affairs, you know, in one of the past governments under His Excellency Rocha Sokoracha. And, you know, she was at one time also very, very, very boisterously involved in, you know, political party affairs, you know, for instance, the People Democratic Party at that time before she went to APC. So my mom, you know, shaped the ideals in a lot of ways about, you know, engaging in the social space. And my writing skills and my reading passion stems from my dad. You know, my dad is a publisher, my dad is a writer, my dad is an academician. He's a silent speaker. I don't know how to explain that. So he says a lot without saying anything, you know. So my dad would look at you, I mean, with one glance, you know what he's saying. And he speaks from a place of depth, and he doesn't say it often. So I think my parents in a lot of ways influenced my life to what I became. I'm very close to my father. I'm close to my mom. But my dad has, you know, this. I leverage more on my dad's sense of advice, because you want me to do anything, just report me to my dad. And my mom knows that. So I think it is this first daughter father relationship thing, and I think it's not my fault. it is ab initio from, you know, nature. And but I think also what I do is that I respect my mom a lot, and I think it was first fear and then respect, because I used to wonder how she was so powerful in doing so many things, you know, at the same time. And, you know, my mom was a full-time housewife. And then, you know, at the same time, she was a teacher to so many. And she was a mother to all. So everything that I have become, even with my job, I'm still very maternal. People wonder why and how I am still down to earth. And I think it's my upbringing. My mother raised us without house girls, just in the later part of our year. So I'm practically the house girl of the house, the nanny of the house, the cook. So growing up, it was quite an experience. Even though then I didn't like it, I felt like people are using me, But, you know, growing up now, I'm grateful because I can multitask. I can do a lot of things. And I come from a very religious family. My granddad was the Archbishop of the Methodist Church in Enugu Diocese, late Archbishop, you know, Joshua Dimoji, who is my mom's father. And he had a great influence on us while growing up. I mean, there are no hymns in the Methodist hymn book that I don't know, because that's how our granddad raised us. And, you know, he had a great influence on me because we were extremely close. And one of the things he also taught me was how to write poetry. So my family, I'm a very familiar person because my family is very close. My siblings and I are like, there's this group back then when we were growing up that we used to model after a lot. Power Rangers. Yeah. So we all had roles in the house. So we had the person who used to mediate, and we had the person who used to, we had the troubleshooter, and then we had the person who was the goal poster who would sit down and analyze, and then we had the person who took records, you know. And even when we probably had family dinners once every Sunday, you know, I think that was the first time my dad said, well, it seems I'm surrounded by feminists in this house. But I think what it did for us is that we grew up together, and we are in each and everybody's business. But now that we're all married, except the last one, what we've done is to reach out to each other once in a while. And even though I'm the first, and I can tell you that with all due respect, I sometimes, you know, sit back and allow them to take the reins and see what's on their mind, and coming, you know, to supervise when push comes to shove. But I can tell you that I have very strong-minded siblings,
yeah,
who are independent-minded. And I think they took one thing or the other from my parents. But I can tell you that it is one of the greatest assets I have in my life, because there are times when I thought I would fall apart and my job was too much, and I had them with me all the time telling me you can go on. So I would end this by saying family is really everything.
Are you a feminist? And how do you see the concept of feminism?
I'm a humanist. I think that's the word I would use. I'm a humanist. And I say that with pure respect to both all genders of mankind. I mean, when people use the word feminist, I think it's appropriate, especially when you're speaking for issues concerning women. Now, people also misunderstand the ideology of feminism. You know, when you talk about being a feminist and also being a gender advocate. So a feminist is centered on women alone and speaking for women's issues, women's rights. But a gender advocate speaks on human rights as concerning a particular gender at a time. So it could be male or female. So, and that's often the question I get on my program, Gender Agenda. They say, oh, you're always talking about women. I said, because at that time, they had the minority clause in that programming. If a male has a problem and I am able to speak in that space, it's still part of the gender's agenda. So it's not necessary to always, you know, when men hear feminists, they just say, oh, these women are like carrying bowls and spears, and they want to spear down the men. They don't want men around them. It has nothing to do with that. I think you guys should just cut us some slack. It just means women speaking for women issues and advocating for women's rights. That's pure and simple.
Thank you. I think I like that. When you're not at work, what do you do for relaxation?
Oh, I like to watch movies and I like to listen to music. I think I spend a lot of time with my husband. We share a lot in common. He's an artist, he's a musician, he's a lover of music. And I mean, I have my own personal karaoke king. So sometimes it's just the bliss in his company. We talk a lot about several things. He's my gossip partner. And if we're not enjoying music, or if we're not talking, we probably, you know, maybe seen a movie, or most importantly, talking about our goals. And I think that's what I enjoy about our companies a lot. And I'm an overthinker. You know, he normally says I analyze everything too much. In fact, I think that's one thing I'm learning not to do so much. We might have a conversation now, and then at 4 hours later, I say, hey, that thing you said, I think I need to dissect it. So, yeah, it's, and then we try to evolve with our taste in things that are leisure, depending. Sometimes we could go visiting a loved one. But I think for me, if you ask me what I do to spend time or to do leisure, is spending time with my partner.
Someone you share interests with.
Absolutely.
What are the things that motivate you, that explain your successes on and off broadcasting?
Humanity. I'm so passionate about seeing a very enabling environment for the younger people coming ahead of us. I am troubled by what we have inherited as adults now. I want a better Nigeria. I want a better service system. I want an enabling environment where young people have a choice to do good and choose good. And that's what I am striving to do in my own little space. And I think another thing that motivates me is the fact that, you know, if you give up on your country, then who works it out? I see a lot of people saying, oh, you need to leave. I mean, there's opportunities elsewhere in the country. You do great there and all of that. Then I look back and I'm saying, if I decide to leave, I mean, if you use the word, the term jackpot, then who now fixes the country of your dreams? Because whether you travel 1,000 miles away and come back 20 years later, you're still Nigerian, regardless. So I think the motivation is the fact that there is a lot of work to do and that the time to do it is now. And I also talk a lot with my father. My dad is my central point of engagement, my husband as well. And for me, just listening to them and hearing the aspirations for a better country, what they wish for, how Nigeria should be, sort of reinforces my ideals to still be responsible for outcomes within my space. And so whether anybody's applauding me or not, whether I'm being validated or not, whether I'm making money or not, if the outcome is positive and someone is enriched with their lives for it, and then I'm doing the right thing.
Yeah, that's true. Thank you. As a motivational speaker, give us 5 rules for a young lady who aspires to be great.
Focus. 5 focuses.
5 focuses.
Yeah, because with focus comes consistency. With focus comes order. With focus comes being deliberate. With focus comes growth and planning. With focus comes self-discovery.
And is there any plan for another shot in politics? Is there any idea or any plan?
None that I have at the moment. But then service is akin to my nature. And if I'm called upon to serve my country, you know, I would serve my country. But to get up and go run for an election, I think there's a lot of things to be fixed in our system. I mean, people are very... Well, they are very distrusting of the institutions, and the believability in the outcomes of elections are very small. So I think until all of those narratives are changing, you don't have to rely on the Godfather, you don't have to rely on money to buy votes, you don't have to rely on the corruption in the system, I think then maybe we'll give it a shot. But until then, to serve, I would readily serve if called upon.
Okay, one final question. You know, in 2020, October, there was this spontaneous NSAS protest around the country. And recently, Enek was saying about the youth constituting a bulk of the voting population. How do you see the voting pattern of the youth? Do you think the NSAS movement will galvanize and manifest themselves at the ballot?
I think things have changed since then. Remember, there was a NASA strike that was almost a year. People were at home sitting down. They were resigned. They were troubled. Some were hungry. There were criminal, you know, cases where people took to more internet fraud, more kidnapping. If you look at the crime ratio within the time when there was NASA strike and now, you see it increased to some point. it's a plausibility that that could have been as a sense of restlessness and lack of, you know, mental stimulation. However, it also shows you the possibility of the still gullible nature of the youth population, of some of the youth population. However, very intelligent, strong-minded youths is what we have. And I'm hoping that the energy that we had during the NSAS will be replicated in the amount of people voting the right leader, not voting for their pockets, not choosing based on peculiar needs, not trying to divert what is really the critical issue into personal gratification. So I'm hoping that the youth population, even when you look at the mathematics, is divided between young women and also young men. So it's not just young boys and young men. So that's what makes up even the 49.something% of women's currency in terms of voting population. So for me, I just feel that that is essential. Okay, that's essential. And the NSAS, of course, you know how it ended. However, I'm hoping that the election is not an NSAS repetition, because then I am hoping that the NSAS was guided by the need for ending police brutality, which probably was not guided by structuring without a leader. But now the leadership of the election is the currency of your voter's card. So there is an outcome expected from you voting the right person.